Welcome to the Manga Health Podcast. Over the coming weeks and months, we will be discussing how assistive technology can help people who may have a medical condition that affects their mobility or finds movement more challenging as they age, live life independently and with dignity. Today we are talking to leading occupational therapist Kate Sheehan. Kate qualified in 1987 and has practiced in both the US and the UK. Kate is the former chairperson and treasurer of the Royal College of Occupational Therapists Specialist Housing Section and represented the College of Occupational Therapists in Europe. She chaired the Gen Home Research Project developing the evidence base for housing modifications. Kate is a director of the OT service, providing OT services internationally. We hope you find our conversation interesting today, and please feel free to drop us an email at podcast@mangahealth.com if you have any comments or questions. Good morning, Kate.
Good morning, Claire.
Today we are going to focus on veterans and the importance of using the right equipment to enable them to return home safely and to live their life as independently as possible. We will also discuss caregivers and the impact of supporting a loved one to return to the challenge of daily life. So the first thing I'd like to discuss this morning, Kate, is what difficulties do veterans encounter when they return home to their communities?
All veterans come back into our communities with needs and challenges following a career in the military. This is impounded or further impacted if a veteran comes out of the services with a psychological, physical, or both impairment. They've come from a career which is very routine focused, where they know what they're doing and when they're doing it and how to do it. They're suddenly thrust into their local communities and they have to develop their own routines and goals and activities to fulfill their life. It's also important that when they return home, we don't just think about the veterans themselves, because the physical and psychological impairments have a huge impact on the wider family, be that a partner, children, or the wider family. And we need to make sure that their needs are taken into account just as much as the veterans' needs. What we really need to do is when that somebody is being discharged from the services, that they have a very focused goals, and that those goals are achievable. So we start with limited goals that might just be they getting up and doing their activities of daily living. But then we might want to focus on things like working with the children, taking the children to school. We might even want to say, what are you going to do to maintain your physical well-being? Because the physical well-being in the services is so important. And we want to carry on that at home. So we need to look at graded approach for supporting people back into the community, because without that purpose and without that routine, they can find it exceedingly difficult.
So what I'm hearing, Kate, really is how the significance of having a goal and the well-being of the veteran who's returning home. So what do you think is the most important thing on the return home? What should we be looking for in the first instance?
I think routine is key. Having a daily routine for somebody's life makes you able to achieve small things quickly and effectively. And for me, it's as an occupational therapist, it's about purposeful occupation. It's not about doing something for the sake of doing something, but doing an activity which leads to a positive outcome. And that can be a positive physical outcome, but also a positive psychological one. We all live our lives having things that we want to achieve. And when we achieve those things, the feeling of well-being is incredible, and it motivates you to carry on to do other things within your life. And this is what we need to do with our veterans returning home. So clearly stating out what their goals are, and those goals can be in various different areas. It could be within physical health, it could be in family life, it could be in getting a job, and I don't necessarily mean paid employment, but some volunteering, something where they can start developing their skills again. But it's also about giving veterans responsibility. They've come from an environment where they are given responsibility constantly. And if they come home and they're not given everything because people are worried about putting too much pressure on them or expecting them physically to do too much, it can be very demoralising. So we must very clearly remember that our veterans not only have physical needs but have emotional needs, and we need to be working on both of those together. So you talk about what's the one key thing. I think there's a number of things that we need to look at. So it's about purposeful occupation, but the other thing that we often forget is about continued counselling. It can be called counselling, it can just be called mindfulness, it can be just a talking group, but something where veterans can talk through issues with other veterans or professionals to deal with all the emotional turmoil that they may have following being at the front line. And we must never ever underestimate the psychological impact of frontline war.
That's really interesting, Kate. I can hear that the importance of small steps, having purpose, really should be a priority for any veteran who is moving back home, maybe after a stay in a veteran facility or other hospital. And they've had such responsibility in their lives, and now maybe they're coming back to a place where having responsibility is difficult because of some physical challenges. And I'm just wondering, what sort of physical challenges do you think veterans may be facing?
There's a number of issues of veterans with physical impairments returning home. The most important one is, do they have an accessible home? Most homes are not wheelchair accessible, or not even designed for people who may be using mobility equipment or have sensory loss. So from my perspective, we really need to look at making their home as easy to use as possible with their specific impairment. So to give you some examples, the bathroom, a room that we all use a number of times throughout the day, that we don't consciously think how we use it as we age. But as soon as you have an impairment, every task in the bathroom becomes slightly more complex. Going to the toilet, can you transfer safely on and off the toilet? Can you do it on your own? Because actually you do not want assistance to be able to transfer onto the toilet. You lose your dignity. And it's the one activity that really you don't want to have anybody else in the room with you. But it's also looking at, have they got the appropriate showering facilities, or do they want to bathe? And we need to look at all those parts of their home to make it accessible. But it's not just about, say, the home, be it the lounge room, be it the kitchen, be it your children's bedrooms, because all of those are so important to get access to. But we have veterans who spend a significant amount of their time outside, and if they can't get outside to their yard, that's going to have a psychological impact on them. So we need to look at, how do we get them outside? Once they're outside, what can they do within the garden? So for example, a wheelchair user, we might need to be looking at raised beds, pathed areas, but not negating the whole wider family use. So dad may still want to be able to, or mum may want to be able to get down to the sandpit to play with the child from their wheelchair. And is the environment that we're developing and working to design and create alongside the veteran and their family going to meet their needs? I think there's also issues of, we need to look at the wider community, because we do not just live in our own home. And actually, a veteran returning home may still want to go to the cinema, they might still want to go to a bar with their mates, they might still want to attend church, they might want to use leisure facilities, and it's looking at how all those things can be made accessible to them. And that also might include driving. Do they have a car that's adapted to meet their needs? But not just their needs, because if they've got children, how are their children going to use that vehicle as well? So we need to look at those issues. And then one of the biggest issues when returning home is looking at what equipment somebody is going to use to enable them to carry out activities of daily living safely. One of the biggest things that veterans return home with if they've had traumatic amputations is a wheelchair. And we need to accommodate that. But with a wheelchair comes other issues around the most appropriate bed. Do we need to be looking at pressure relief, so a special pressure mattress? Do we need to look at special seating within the lounge room or in the snug? And we need to look at possibly grab rails or falls equipment. And we need to think of all those at the time of discharge. So the veteran who's used those equipment feels comfortable with those equipment and can use them to enable daily life.
You mentioned at the end there equipment, and I'm just wondering, have you ever come across a reluctance to use equipment?
I think there's a huge reluctance to accept equipment, and it's around the disability equipment market. And the fact that people see it as a negative, they see it as something that is abnormal, that is disabling, that's institutionalising, and most of the equipment can look like a hospital facility rather than designed for a home environment. It's something that I feel really passionate about, because we need to start changing attitudes that equipment that's within this market is not about disability. It is about enablement. It's a positive piece of equipment. It's useful. It allows me to do the activities I want to do when I want to do it. And I always say, you know, you can look at all sorts of examples, but you would never see a microwave as a piece of disability equipment. And yet, in my practice, I use it huge amounts of times for independence, because it's often easier to use and quicker to use for somebody who has, say, fatigue problems. If you want to get yourself a meal quickly, you can do it so much quicker in a microwave than you can in a standard oven or on a stovetop. So we need to see equipment as enabling, not disabling. Because if I say to you, get a microwave, you wouldn't see that as a piece of disability equipment. And yes, it's supporting you with your impairments to achieve what you want to achieve. I think it's also, we need to maybe look at some of our equipment and say, can we make our equipment slightly different? Or can we adapt it slightly to make it more aesthetically pleasing? But fundamentally, some of the equipment that we use, you can't do that because it's not seen as a piece of equipment that would be normally seen in a home. And there stands the issue. We need to therefore make sure that this equipment is not seen as different. It's seen as a positive bit of kit. So to give you an example, if you'd fallen, so you're doing a transfer, you'd fallen in your lounge, you need to get up quickly, because we know it's really important for people to get up quickly after a fall. If a piece of equipment is going to get you up within 4 to 5 minutes from start to finish, back onto your wheelchair, back into a chair, isn't that a positive piece of equipment? Just like a microwave or Siri or a shower is. So we must see these pieces of equipment as a enabler and not something that's negative.
You've covered off a really wide range of equipment and needs there, Kate. And I think, you know, to be able to live successfully and independently, there are lots of different bits of equipment that can be used to support someone in their own home. But interestingly, whatever equipment that you have that is there to help someone, people will still fall. And you mentioned falls there at the end. And I'm just wondering, actually, how protective do we need to be of this group of people? Or actually, is risk still really important?
I think we need to be completely honest and recognise that most people who go into a military career and are specifically on the front line are risk takers. And they've chosen that career probably because that's what they love to do. If somebody then goes home and every piece of risk is managed to the nth degree, that is going to become quite a dull existence. And we need to understand that veterans will still need to take risks. Now, that could be risks like playing murder ball or wheelchair rugby, where if you watch a match, it's quite stressful to see what they do to themselves and they bash each other around. But you can see the passion in their play, and we don't want to lose that passion, because life is about passion, and if we can't do what makes us passionate, we become quite psychologically damaged. You know, if you can't do what you want to do, it has a huge impact on your mental well-being. So for me, when I'm looking with veterans when they're returning home, it's what can we do about risk? So what do they want to do? Maybe they do want to fling themselves around the home from one surface to another, that they may want to go out into the garden and maybe be on the floor doing activities, or maybe they do want to be in their garage building a motorbike, or whatever they want to do. There's going to be an element of risk, but what we do is what we talk through what the possible risks are and then how we can manage them, and we say, we never say no, always say yes, but how are we going to do it, and then work out the equipment that we need to make that task or that activity achievable. But I think risk is a really interesting topic at the moment, and I think we've come from a very protective kind of cotton wool approach to people with disabilities, and almost say to them, you can't take risks because you've got an impairment. And that is so, so wrong. We all take risks in life. We all do slightly mad things at different times in our lives, but we choose to do it. And just because you have a disability or an impairment that impacts your function does not mean that we can stop them taking risks. And for me, the more risks they take, especially from a veteran point of view, the happier you will have a client. But it's also about looking at these risks sensibly. And people will often say to me, well, they can't do this and you can't do that and you can't do the other. But actually, if you look at our life, and I'll give you a couple of examples. We have things to manage risks around our home, don't we? Every single one of us will have a point in the home where we can turn off the water. That's managing the risk of potential flooding. It's sensible, isn't it? Most of us will wear a helmet when cycling. That's a sensible risk avoidance. It's not going to stop us riding. It will just hopefully decrease any risks of falling off. We have airbags in our car, don't we? And we see those as normal. But what they're there to do is if we do have a crash or a bang, we're safeguarded. So what we need to do is think of equipment that we have in the home that prevents risks or enables to manage risks are just like our airbags, our helmets, our water stopcocks. They're all the same thing. It's just, again, it's coming back to this acceptance again, isn't it? That we need to allow people to live their lives how they want to. And veterans, by the nature of their career choice, are more likely to be risk takers. And as far as I'm concerned, go for it. If that's what you want to do, go for it.
Okay, so I think what I'm hearing here really is that assistive technology equipment can actually help empower people to live a normal life. This is about normalising life for individuals, not actually putting everybody in a group and saying, well, they have limited mobility because they're a veteran, and so we would go this certain route. This is about enabling them to do the tasks and the activities, the leisure activities that they want to do, and that equipment can sometimes just give them that edge to be able to do it, and it for it to be risk-free.
Totally. No, I totally agree with you, Claire. And I think what you've raised there that I really need to address as well is about every single veteran has different needs. There isn't, you can't label a group of, say, somebody with sensory impairments or a group of people who are amputees. Every individual client is different. And that's where occupational therapy can work really well with a client, because we put the client at the centre of the practice and we can look at what's important to them, because actually what's important to one person is not to another. And what we can do is use the equipment to enable them to do what they want to do when they want to do it.
Do you have any examples of individualising care through the use of equipment?
I do. A couple of two very different examples. I've got an example of a young man returning home following traumatic amputations. He was blown up on front line and he had a young family. And the one thing that he was really keen on, and his wife, was that kind of Sunday morning, lying in bed with your kids, reading books, laughing and play fighting. But the issue was, it was very difficult for Dad to actually get to the bedrooms to bring the children back. So we worked on the children, who were quite young at the time, that they could go in on a Sunday to Dad. And we purchased a bed that would go quite low to the floor. And the children realised that Daddy would take the bed down and they would jump onto Daddy, and then he'd take the bed up so he was at the same height of his wife. And although that seems quite minor to some people, the joy in that family of being able to spend time together in bed, doing the things they wanted to do, and the kids developing their own independent living skills, but also reducing the effort that Dad had to do to actually get his children, meant that the energy that he had was all about his children. And I cannot even begin to describe his face when he realised that that was going to be happening every Sunday. And he did say to us at the end, that's going to happen until they're 21. I'm not quite sure whether the children would agree with that, but that's what he intended. I think the other example is a little bit more extreme, of a lady who had a traumatic injury. And when lying in bed in hospital, and the first time I'd seen her 4 weeks post accident, I said to her, what's your goals? And she just looked me in the eye, really, it was quite a distressing look, saying, all I want to do is be able to ski with my daughter again. And really, we had a long process of having to get that lady from a hospital bed to an appropriate home, to back to work, to an environment where she could actually take her daughter to school and attend school events, and for her to be strong enough. And actually, I didn't see the end result, but what I did see was I got a text message whilst at work one day, and there was a picture of this lady in Switzerland with her daughter skiing down the hill, and it just said, got there. And for me, that is why I love my job.
Thanks for those closing stories, Kate. I think everyone will feel very affected by those, and just how much with the right care and attention from a good clinician, you can get on and live a full life. I think to close, just to summarise what we've been talking about today, what's come out of our chat is really that the client has to be at the centre of the care, and looking and listening to their goals is the most important thing we can do to help them live their lives to the full. And that equipment actually should be viewed as enabling and empowering. Finally, we should be enabling veterans to take risks. This is important, and it's good for their well-being and to live life as they choose. So thanks for your time today, Kate. As I said at the beginning of the podcast, if anyone's got any comments or questions, please feel free to email us at podcast@mangahealth.com, and we will respond to your questions and comments. And thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Claire, for the opportunity to speak about a subject that is so important to my heart. Important to my heart. Important to my heart. Important.